publisher of Dalit studies or a publisher that publishes on caste as a central focus. But all of us see ourselves as publishers who publish from the margins, about the margins, and we look at margins in different ways. So that's really what we are going to be talking about today. Let me introduce my panelists first of all. So Meghi Ben is from an organization called Kutch Mahila Vikas Sangathan, which is based in Kutch. And is it okay if I speak a little in Hindi so that she also understands?
Yeah.
And then if you want me to translate, yeah, I'm happy to do that. So Meghi Ben KMVS की सदस्य हैं, कच्छ में एक महिला संस्था है और काफी सालों से महिलाओं के साथ काम कर रहे हैं। तो मेरी बहन और राधा बहन इकट्ठे काम करते हैं और आप लोग एक अखबार भी निकालते हैं। मेरी बहन क्या उजाला,
उजास पत्रिका,
उजास पत्रिका, और दूसरी आपने शुरू की है अभी हाल में, आप कह रही थी एक दूसरी पत्रिका शुरू की है कि वही है उजास पत्रिका, उजास पत्रिका। So she will talk a little bit about Ujas Patrika. मैं ये कह रही हूँ कि आप Ujas Patrika के बारे में कुछ बात करेंगे। अभी पहले मैं इन दोनों का भी परिचय करा दूँ, फिर उसके बाद। So Meghi Ben works with KMVS and works with a group of women there, and they work across caste. And the women bring out a newspaper called Ujas Patrika, and they have also with Radha Ben created a book of which maps visually the life of women in Kutch. Looks at what globalization has done to their lives, looks at how they have fought violence against women in daily life, how they have dealt with the police, how they have taken things into their own hands and brought out their own patrika and so on. And she will talk a little bit about that. Then on the panel is Ruby Hembrom, who's here, and Ruby recently started a publishing house called Adiwani, which publishes basically tribal literature, writings by tribal people, and she is based in Kolkata. And Ruby will talk about the story of how she was inspired to do this and what the challenges and opportunities and limitations have been. And then on my far right is Arpita Das, who is well known to many people in this room. And Arpita started many years ago an imprint called Yoda Press, which focuses on all the interesting kinds of writing that mainstream publishers do not focus on and are not interested in and feel they cannot make money from. One of Arpita's central areas of attention has been sexuality studies. And today she's going to speak a little bit about the focus on transgender. As publishers, then you might think that we are the big publishers as compared with the smaller publishers, because many years ago, 30 years ago when we started, we saw ourselves in Kali and later in Zuban as an alternative to the mainstream, publishing works on and by women. And over the period of those three decades, trying to understand and unpack women as a category so that it was not, so that we didn't just inhabit the comfort zone of sitting in Delhi and publishing literate Western women who wrote in English, but needed to go beyond that and learned how to go beyond that to look at different forms of marginalization. But because we've had a longer history, because we, in terms of size, are a somewhat bigger publisher than, say, Ruby, who has started up, and so on. So within the world of alternative publishing, we are often seen as closer to the mainstream than to the alternative. So there are far fewer works by women writers than there are by male writers, but as happens when a new area of publishing or when publishers start to go beyond what they are doing and start looking at new material, there comes a point when that new material also within quotes starts to seem sexy. Because it brings you, and I'm using that word within quotes, because it brings you a kind of credibility or a kind of political acceptance, which many mainstream publishers would like to have. And then as a publisher who wears their politics on their sleeves, I think as all of us do, you are caught between these two things of wanting to make your publishing much more inclusive, but needing to be very careful about not falling into the trap of doing it simply because there is, at the moment, an opening or an address, interest and so on. It's the same thing, for example, as publishing of writers from the Northeast, who, if you look back over 20 years in English publishing, you don't see much publishing from the Northeast. You don't see many writers from the Northeast. It's not as if they were not writing. But now, 30, 32 years ago, we did so because we felt the world of mainstream writing and publishing was ignoring, not paying attention to, marginalizing the writings of women. And that while these writings existed, nobody was actually publishing them. And we felt as publishers that because we were in this for the politics, that whenever mainstream publishers stepped in and said, okay, we'll publish women, we felt, why should they? We need to publish ourselves. We have to have our own voices. We have to have our own platforms. I think that in many ways, that is the kind of discussion that we now have with Dalit writers and Dalit publishers who feel about people like us, that why should we go to them and why should we not create our own platforms? And I think that's
Rashad jo hai hum log jab chhapne jaate hain jab kitabon ko prakashit karne jaate hain to jaise ki hum kahe ki hum mahilaon ke bare mein kitabein chhap rahe hain to sirf wahan par seema nahi ruk jati kyunki mahila bhi har tarah ki mahila hoti hai ऊंचे वर्ग की महिला हो सकती है नीची जाति की महिला हो सकती है शहरी महिला हो सकती है कहीं और की महिला हो सकती है तो हमें ये देखना है कि किस तरह उसमें भी हम हर तरह की आवाज़ को सामने लाएं ना और दूसरा कि जब और भी जैसे अल्पसंख्यक या दलित कहानियाँ हम छापने जाते हैं तो उसी तरह के प्रश्न उठते हैं इसमें कि क्या हम खुद छापें जैसे आप लोग अपनी पत्रिका छापती हैं या फिर आपके पास कोई बड़ा पत्रकार आके बोले कि हम आपकी पत्रिका छाप देंगे और आपकी आवाज दुनिया तक पहुंचा देंगे तो उसमें आपके सामने क्या प्रश्न उठते हैं तो संक्षेप में मैंने ये बात सबको बताई है कि हम इन इस तरह के प्रश्नों पे बात करेंगे तो आप अगर अब अपनी पत्रिका के बारे में और अपने कुछ काम के बारे में थोड़ा बहुत बताएंगे लोगों को और हिंदी में बीच बीच में गुजराती के शब्द आप इस्तेमाल करना चाहें तो थोड़े बहुत कर सकते हैं। You have Gujarati, okay, great. हाँ, because she was a bit worried कि Gujarati में बोलेंगे कि हिंदी में बोलेंगे।
That is half Gujarati
है। And
other half is Punjabi.
मेरा नाम मेगी बेन सामरिया है और गांव मुंबई और तालुका भुज जिला भुज कच्छ 30 साल से मैं एक कच्छ महिला विकास संगठन में जुड़ी हूँ जुड़ी तो संगठन बनाया तो हमारा तो पता नहीं था कि संगठन कैसा है क्या काम करेंगे सुषमा बेन आया गांव में आते थे जाते थे राधा बेन जैसा लोग जजीबा में कुंवर बेन लीडर बेन था आकीवान बेनों है तो मिलता था ना आते थे ना जाते थे मेरा गांव में काम शुरू किया तो हैंडीक्राफ्ट से मैं शुरू किया था कच्छ में बहुत भूकंप आते हैं तो साल बरसात आती है तो 3 साल तो भूकंप आते हैं तो ये महिला दरबार है कि कोई मालदारी है तो हमारा देश वंचित है ये तो कला है पर थनाकर करते हैं तो बहुत तकलीफ होती है तो बाद में थोड़ा थोड़ा संगठन बनाया महिला मंडल बनाया और पशुपालन वाला और हैंडीक्राफ्ट वाला संगठन बना, महिला मंडल बनाया बाद में, और खान थोड़ी थोड़ी, पहला तो बोलते थे कि ऐसा बेन आते हैं तो सीआरडी करते हैं तो नहीं जाना, हमारा कुटुंब में बोलते थे कि ये तो बढ़ेला गणेला छे, ये तो तमीने तो क्या न क्या नहीं जैसे, तो कोई विश्वास से नहीं करते थे। तो बाद में थोड़ा थोड़ा आते थे जाते थे, मैं निगम का काम करती थी, थोड़ा थोड़ा ले जाती थी, ले आते महिला मंडल एक शुरू है, आ मोटी मोटी बातों नहीं तो अमने खबर पर नहीं है। तो बे पानी उजास पत्रिका बार पाड़ी भेगा थाई, बीजो तो काम हतो नहीं, अत्यारे जे मोटा काम थई गया ई काम तो त्यारे हता नहीं। तो बैठे बैठे पोताना गाम नी वात एमां नाखवानी के पोताना गाम मां काई पण एवो मुद्दो पहले थी एवा मुद्दा राख्या के बेन कोई केडी एवोर्ड मळे, कोई हारो भरत भरता होय, क्या मीटिंग थई होय, એવા પ્રોત્સાહન મળે એવા વિગત રાખતા ગયા એમ। અને ઘણીવાર એવો બન્યો કે કોઈ દલિત બેન ગામમાં દલિત બેન રહેતી હોય તો એની છોકરી હોય કે પોતે હોય એમ, તો ત્યાં ઘણા બધા એવા કિસ્સા પણ બનવા મળ્યા, કોઈ રેપના, કોઈ શેરડીના, તો એ કિસ્સા પત્રિકામાં કઈ રીતે રાખવા એમ। તો કોઈ કંટ્રોલમાં ઓછો ભાવે દાન મળતો હોય, પૂરો ન મળે, કેરોસીન ન મળે, ત્યાંથી પૂરો આવે ને ગરીબ લોકોને ન મળે, એક દિવસ જ ખુલે, ઘણા બધા મુદ્દા હતા કઈ રીતે છાપવા એ। એમાં એક મુદ્દો અમે કેરોસીનનું સરપંચબેન ઉછાઈ હતી તો માહિતી દીધી, તો અમે છાપી ગયા એની અંદર, અમે એની ખબર નહીં પણ અમે છાપી ગયા, ગામ ગામ માહિતી ગઈ, તો કે આ અમારા નામ નાખે તો અમને મજા આવી જાય, મેગી બેન સાંભળ્યા છે તો
in the village, and he was afraid. So there's a power of print, that you know, he was afraid of being named in the patrika. So that is very strange.
One of the interesting things about the Khabar Lehriya women is that initially they were doing the same kind of thing of local news, you know, what is happening in somebody's life and how are they mobilizing, which issue and so on. Then the women started going further afield and reporting from the neighboring villages, and then it turned out that many of the mainstream newspapers in that region started to ask the women to be stringers for them, because they found that the kind of news that the women were producing, there was a lot of interest in that in the mainstream, which they had never tried to do. So here were these women who now became their own editors, their own printers, their own journalists, but at the same time were able to be stringers for mainstream newspapers, which gave them a little bit of money, which also allowed them to get out far and wide and collect different kinds of news. So there was a kind of very interesting empowerment and a setting up of the tension that that automatically sets up when you disturb the power equation, the kind of difficulties that women have when they move out of the so-called given space. And of course, women, low-caste women particularly, when they're taking print and when they're taking the media into their own hands, provides a very specific kind of threat. So if Meera had been here, she would have told you that story in much more detail, but I just wanted to briefly mention. And then we'll move to Ruby and Arpita, which is a different kind of story. And Ruby, I'll ask you to go first and talk about your work.
So 3 years ago, I practically strayed into publishing. I strayed into a publishing course only because my sister happened to work for the publishing house, the Siegel, that was conducting it for the first time. Now it was a 4-month course, I had some time in hand. I was not, I had quit my full-time job to start a training institute for English language for Adivasis. So I happened to go into this course, and the first part of the 4-month course was called Publishing Lives, and we were meeting people, everyone from the publishing industry. So people from established mainstream publishing houses like HarperCollins. I am sitting there, the only Adivasi in this group of 24, thinking this is wonderful. So they're doing something so niche, And I look at the list of people we were to meet, and there was not one Adivasi name. And that did it for me. I was like, this can't be happening all over again. I mean, I don't really have time to tell you about my growing up years and how my experience in school was. So I said, this exclusion can't be happening all over again. Something has to be done. Who would do it? So it was day three, and I said, I have to do it. I can't wait. I don't know how to do it, but I will find a way. So that is how the idea was born. And by the end of the 4 months, I was paying less and less attention to the course, and my alternate parallel agenda of building this publishing house started. I was very fortunate to meet my best collaborators on the course. So there was this graphic designer from Bhopal, very interested in tribal art, but she had not heard of the Santals. She only thought the Gonds were the only tribals in India. So I gave her a lesson on Santals and told her who they are and all of that. So primarily in 4 months, we had Adivani. It was registered. It was a publishing house, but we had no books, no authors, and I didn't know how to get to the next stage. But then I was told by my friends, look around you. What is around you? Look at stories that you grew up with. Now, most people don't understand that I didn't come from a reading culture. As a second generation educated person, born to first generation migrant parents who never read, we had no books around us. The only books that were there were our textbooks and my father's books that he had to do with his profession. So we didn't know what classics were, so I didn't have that background. So a lot of people now ask me, so you're into publishing, so you love books, you must have read so much. I don't know what they're talking about. So this is how it... Now, tribal languages are not even regional languages, which is why the circulation or let's say the readership is very, very limited. So I said, this isn't true. So what is the problem? Why are we not being paid any attention to? So I realized that the gap had to be in the language in which we were publishing. So I said, I'm not going to do Santali, I'm not going to do the native languages, they already are being done. Let me not duplicate what's happening. Let me not do regional languages, Hindi, Bangla, it's all being done. Let me choose English and let me try and see if it works for us in getting the kind of attention that we need. And that's how I started with my first few books, and the gamble, the risk paid off. So in 3 years, we have 13 books, and we keep going on. But then I'm not sure we have time for challenges and all that right away. So this is how it started.
You can just mention a little bit about challenges.
Okay, so the first book I did was in Santali, because that was a manuscript ready. My father was translating his doctoral thesis into Santali. So I said, give it to me. I need something to start with. I'm a publishing house and I don't have any books, you better give it to me. So he would have self-published it anyway. That's what most Adivasis do. They self-publish it. It may look not very beautiful, you know, like cheap paper and just kind of stapled together, sellotaped together, but it sells, people read. So I went with that book to a printer, and we went to a mid-level printer. So the cover was black, and with the Santal if dancing girls, dressed like I am, across the cover. So the printer looks at the book, she knew it was about the Santals. In Bengal, people know who Santals are. And she looks at me and she says, why don't you change this black to a cheery yellow or a bright maroon? You know, because black is too sophisticated a color for the very backward Santals. I was in tears. I mean, I don't know whether she knew there was a Santals sitting in front of her, but it was too bad. I went home and I said, I'm not sure I have it in me to do this, because growing up in school, I mean, very quickly, you know, I felt this immediate isolation. It didn't really fit in, because there were things. One, you go to the most elite school, where you have the industrialist children, the chief minister's grandchildren studying over there. And you may think what my parents did to have me study there, they just chose to convert to the right religion. So Christians, a Christian school, that's how I got to go there. Now, very young, I was about 6 years old, my classmates started making fun of the way I looked. So I was the only dark-skinned girl. So not only was I Adivasi, I was dark-skinned, and that was really, I had no right to exist. So they would say, ah, so when you polish your shoes in the morning, do you polish your face as well? So I would come home crying, and they would, you know, there are a lot of other stories in the way my parents dealt with it, pretty interesting. But there was a lot of other things that were happening that made me realize I was different. So even though I went to the school where I'm supposed to learn and be educated and be better at, and when I came home, my parents didn't know that also. So, you know, we kind of asked around, and so that's when. But so when your bottle, your feeding bottle is filled with, let's say, lentil soup or your rice starch, you don't know what Cerelac or Pharynx is. So there were things like that, it kept happening. So I knew at that point, 3 years ago, that someone had to do something. It was time that we spoke for ourselves. So I decided to start this publishing house, which would only publish in English, and I would only publish Adivasis. So that's how it was. I have many stories, but
it's so many. Okay, after that.
Thanks. That is recognized by law of India. It interestingly happened in the same year when the Supreme Court went back on the High Court order to decriminalize homosexuality. So that's the strange kind of contradiction we live with in our laws here. That the same year that they said, no, we can't decriminalize homosexuality yet, the same year they recognized transgenders. Whatever that means. But what the law has done is supremely important, of course. It has allowed my transgender friends and authors to ask for something, to demand something that they had no right to before this. But it's really changed on paper. If you talk to them, they will tell you that it has really just changed on paper. And that, of course, is a very, very long time before our attitudes changed to the reading list for sexuality studies. But it was very sad that we could manage just two transgender narratives in a collection of about 27. And the reason we found was because at that point we were having to translate. And we were given that, you know, we wanted to. So this was the first LGBT anthology of this sort where we were doing it non-anonymously, as in everybody who was writing from the queer community was doing it under their own name, and they were talking about personal narratives. This was not fictionalized in any way. So we were trying to do everything different. Your own voice, that mattered a lot. But when it came to the transgender narratives, we failed because we had to translate. And we felt that for sure some of it must have been lost in that translation. But 10 years on, I think I'm really happy to say that we're getting to a point now with activists like Eri Bhatti and Akkai Padmashali, who are transgender activists, very articulate. It's the one thing that is common to all these narratives, and it comes up again and again. Most of these narratives are of people who have been cast out by their families once they became very open about their sexual preference. That's where really the story of the violence has begun. And once they are cast out, they really have no, they have no self almost. I mean, some of the sort of biggest, the constant sort of occurrence of stories of violence is from the police, because be it physical violence, sexual violence of Hijras and Kutis by the police. I mean, I think that is the constant part of that narrative. How the law not just, I mean, it does not recognize them, but on the one hand, I mean, to begin with, and then on the other hand, they are being subject to such brutal violence and oppression. And, you know, there is a lot of talk now, post December 16th, about how marital rape in India is of no importance to anyone. The other kind of rape in India that is of no importance to anyone is the rape of transgenders. And this constant association of them, that is, the other kind of phenomenon in these narratives, the constant association of them with sex work. And the fact is that Mukhtar's event just last weekend, and she said that if you are not going to give me the right to live the way I want to get to the job I want to go send my children, you know, the child that I have adopted or who has been given to me by my shakha, because finally family for them becomes a very sort of nebulous guru shishya kind of a situation where there are a number of people who are under the patronage of a vidra guru, and this is their family, and they adopt in turn others. And she said, if you're not going to allow me to send my child to school or celebrate a wedding in the community, then you have no right to tell me who to have sex with or not, and what sort of clothes I should wear. And I think really that is the linchpin of these narratives. And I just want to end by saying that these are narratives that need to come out so much more. I mean, you were talking about timing. I feel for the Hijras, there's never any good timing in terms of anyone thinking this is politically important. They are the one, I mean, and people go to them for votes, but then when it comes to talking about their issues, for me, it definitely has something, of course, to do with their sexual orientation. Yeah. So, yeah.
Authorship when you are actually publishing, and I think that's one of the things that comes up constantly. Then I think you have to also rethink how we conceptualize books, because the book itself is in question as a complete story. So for example, if you look at the book that was published by Navayana, Father May Be an Elephant and Mother is Only a Basket, each of those stories defies what actually a story is. There is no beginning, there's no middle, there's no end. It's sometimes a vignette, it sometimes leaves a story half told, but cumulatively it adds up to an experience which is important to know. But as a publisher, you, when you're looking at work like that, then you have to train your eye also to look at it differently, and then you have to educate the reader also, because in some ways the work of publishing subversive literatures and works of publishing political literatures and political works, you can't just put it out there in the market and expect that it will have a life. Because first of all, the market doesn't really care, and the market is only interested in Chetan Bhagat and Amish Tripathi. And you have to find the space somewhere in there for this work to enter and to be seen and to be understood. And that is not easy, and the enterprise of that means working with readers to educate readers, which is why for publishers like us, the whole interaction with the readers becomes much more important.
That could be something that you did in Zubani, is instructive. When you publish Baby Haldar, A Life Less Ordinary, why did you tie up with Baby? Why exactly? I want to know. I don't know. Why did you tie up with Baby? Pardon me if it sounds very cynical. It seems like you people are being species of native informants. You're getting, as you said, voices from the margins, presences from the margins, presenting them to the world, and then the larger forces in the world lap them up. And there you are. You've got everything.
Okay, we'll take a few questions, I think. There was a question at the back there.
Yeah, just out of curiosity, did you actually publish the book with those seven four?
Yes.
Did you?
Yes.
What's the name of the book?
Shareer Ki Jankari. It's still my best-selling book, 80,000 copies.
Okay, thank you.
मेरा सवाल नीति बेन से है। मैं ये पूछना चाहती हूँ कि जब सुषमा बेन आपके गांव में आई और जब आपने ये संगठन बनाना शुरू किया तो पुरुष वर्ग का रवैया उस वक्त क्या था? क्योंकि मुझे जहाँ तक याद है कि यहाँ जैसे हम बातें करते हैं जब हम ये काम and they will say that this is the woman who is you know destroying our house, she is the one. तो आप लोगों ने जब ये संगठन बनाया तो उस वक्त क्या आपके पुरुषों ने आपको अलाउ किया कि आप जाइए अपना काम करिए? मेरे ख्याल से शायद ये आपके लिए इतना आसान नहीं होगा।
नहीं, ये मैं बोली थी तो सुषमा बेन आती थी तो बोलते थे ये तो आते हैं तो सीआरडी है, सुषमा बेन और मीना बेन अंगा बेन ये तो सीआरडी है तो आपको तो लेके जाएंगे, ये बोलते थे लोग। पर साथ एक आवक का साधन था ना, हिंदी का भरते थे ना ये लोग। हमारी का किया छापा, मैं पहला बात करती थी ना, एक केरोसिन वाला था कंट्रोल वाला, इनकी मायकी डाल दी वो पत्रिका में तो केस हो गया। दरबार के लोग नहीं ऐसा था, हमारा राधा बेन पे केस कर दिया कि क्यों ये दलित बेन ऐसा पत्रिका बात पाते हैं, हमारा बदनाम करते हैं। एक सरपत बेन चुटा आ गई 33% में, एक सरपत बेन दमयंती बेन करके होश में बोल गई कि हमारा कंट्रोल है ना तो कमेटी वाला केरोसिन नहीं देता, तो एक मायती तो पत्रिका में डाल दी, बधे जगह मायती गई तो कंट्रोल वाला था, इनका तो इज्जत गई ना, इसलिए ही कंट्रोल वाला मारा काका हमारा पे केस कर दिया। तो मैं अलका बेन, राधा बेन और वकील प्रकाश भाई इनके घर गया, बाकी बेन ने तो मुंद्रा में तो लगन कर दिया है ऐसा बोलता था, राग टूटता था। राधा बेन और प्रीति बेन हम लोग साथ में था, क्या है ये निरंतर वाला हमारा तालीम देने आते थे, दीप्ता बेन जया बेन ये तो ये दिल्ली से आते थे ना तो हमारा ये सीखने के लिए, तो हम लोग दो दिन रुकते थे तो लोग बात करते थे। अत्यार मैं दिल्ली आई हूँ, अवार्ड मिला है तो ऐसा अच्छा है तो नहीं बोलते, पर थोड़ा बुरा हो जाते हैं ना तो सब लोग बोलते हैं ऐसा।
Vajpayee, and then also Rabindranath Tagore, and said the odd thing was it all started in Santhalland, where an honorary Santhal named Rabindranath Tagore to be knighted within the face of the British government. I just thought this is really shocking because she's just making it about these elite writers and talking about freedom of expression, but silencing him, meanwhile, because not actually discussing his book, but the issue also is that a year before he had been given a Academy Award, and he, you know, is feeling very uncomfortable that this issue has been foisted on his book, and he has, you know, he's feeling pressurized. Maybe I should be returning my award, but I don't want to, and I'm trapped between, you know, this being an anti-national or being, you know, the writing gang would be criticized and mean that I'm. So anyway.
They went to a lot, I mean, not, they didn't go. People were telling them, why don't you write and publish and all of that. And they were very tempted to go to these mainstream publishers. At one point, they didn't like the way they were treated, you know. So they said, they want to publish us, but they don't know how to treat us. I mean, what the hell was that? So then they decided to start their own publishing house. And then someone told them about me, and they said, when we have our own, why do we need to have another publishing house? So they came to me, and now we have our first academic title. So quite the opposite's been happening. So there is this kind of community bonding among those writers. So I don't see that it is self-defeating or any of that.
Because it's not particularly poetic, right? It's not something that you can exoticize in any way, you can project, package in any way. It's just out there, sometimes extremely sort of with a brute force, you know, just saying this is my life and this is what happened to me. And there's fiction there's poetry there's non-fiction narratives, and no mainstream publisher right now, at least that I'm aware of, comes to touch it. But I do want to say that we completely take on board the fact that you know, independent publishers create certain spaces, certain voices are find their way out through independent publishers for the first time, and then very often those voices do migrate. Number one, I've never seen that as a massive problem, because as many of my colleagues said, they do come back as well. And then there are other voices, because I think we are always interested in mining new voices. That's what really interests us, which is why we have left mainstream publishing jobs, which would probably earn us 6 or 7 figures many, many years ago, and continue to have a fairly harried existence. The second thing is that we're also always on the lookout to find solutions to make sure that our voices get the right kind of distribution. I don't think there is a day when we do not give some part of our time to figuring out what we can do next for that particularly challenging voice, which will not find its way out that easily. So I don't know if that answers anyone's question, but what's the alternative? That we stop doing it?
Yeah.
Let me just quickly add to...
May I ask one question? One question.
You have questions?
Yeah. I'm also a delegate. Okay. It's just about, you know, the language that you took up, English, you know. My question is that sometimes when I speak Hindi, after half an hour, the speaker start asking, what is your caste? And if I speak English for 10 hours, they don't ask me. I mean, how do you see this? I mean, sometimes it takes 2-3 months also, you know, they don't ask me. And in some friendships, it has taken 10 years, but as soon as I start speaking Hindi, after 10 minutes, they say, what is your caste? This is a very, you know, problematic, and you took up English to teach tribal people. Yeah. I mean,
we would have a wider readership.
No, that's right. Okay. Yeah, yeah. My the idea is that, do you have some explanation to this question, actually? I have almost left speaking Hindi, you know. Because either you fight with them at that moment, then after two questions, I say, who are you? Ask me, Vinod Verma. Which Verma? Okay? I said, which Verma do you want? Okay. So say, well, Verma, Dalitsa Verma, then Obisiza Verma, then Kayastha Verma, then, you know, reps, you know. So I said, maybe, Brahminsa Verma. So sometimes, you know, recently I was in half marathon, okay, and I had my camera, etc. I was taking covering the show, okay, and suddenly somebody stopped there, okay, and said, will you take my photograph? I said, fine, yes. Then he shook hands. What's your name? Vinod Verma. Oh, are you a kayast?
Yeah.
I said, you are in half marathon. So you complete it. Yes.
I think we need to have a separate discussion. Publisher, it used to infuriate me. I used to get really, really upset. But then I realized that this is the task we have set ourselves. We have set ourselves this task of going out there, finding new voices. And if those new voices move on into what is called the mainstream, well, that's fine. We can tell ourselves we have been successful at our task. Some of them may come back to us, some of them may not. So that's one part of it. As you've seen from what Mandira and Arpita said, and also what Ruby said, log aate hain, log jaate hain, it's nothing you can help. Why did we team up with Penguin, or why did Arpita team up with Sage, or why did Mandira team up with Sage? You know, survival is damn tough for all of us, because no matter that the market may not be as unidimensional as I made it out to be, but the fact is that we cannot any longer survive on the money that we earn from the books that we publish. Because we are political publishers, we feel obliged, and I think it's right for us to keep the prices of our books low, lower than, say, OUP or others would. But that means that we are battling with constantly rising prices of production, rising salaries, rising rentals, and so on and so forth. Before we arrived here, Arpita and I were talking, and I was saying to her, we cannot afford to pay for the office we are in anymore another 4 months, and we'll have to either work from home, because it's either the office or a salary or cut down on 5 books. So you have to find a way of surviving, and the choice is, can you survive keeping your politics intact? Can you survive dealing with the market? Because remember, we are political, but we are also commercial. It's an uneasy bedfellow thing. And we have to do that, and there is no way you can retain a purity, and purity is itself questionable. So we enter into partnerships which can be exploitative, but which can also be helpful, and it's a constant balancing act.